Hello everyone, my name is Ilya Levitsky. I am a researcher at Wireless Networks Lab in Institute for Information Transmission Problems. And today I will give a talk about my recent paper called Analysis of NSTR Multilink Operation in the Presence of Legacy Devices in an IEEE 802.11be network. So, as we all know, the demands for higher throughput in wireless networks keep growing. Moreover, modern applications also require low latencies, posing a whole new challenge for the developers of wireless networks, including the developers of the Wi-Fi standard, IEEE 802.11. To address this challenge, the new 802.11be standard amendment has been initiated. It will serve for the new generation of Wi-Fi networks, also known as Wi-Fi 7. As of today, one of the most anticipated features of 11BE and the focus of my presentation is the multilink operation. Basically, multilink operation will allow a pair of connected Wi-Fi devices to stream data to each other via several links. In these links, located at different channels, and they can even have different bandwidth and can be located in different bands. For example, one in 2.4 GHz band and another one in 5 GHz band. The multilink operation turns out to be very useful. Not only it allows to nominally reach throughputs that are the sum of the throughputs of individual channels, but also it will allow seamless and nearly instant load balancing between the links. However, in some cases, for example, if the links operate in the channels close to each other, the multilink operation may be impaired by a cross-link interference. So it is unable to perform simultaneous transmission and reception, and is hence called non-simultaneous transmission reception, or NSTR, MLDE, or multilink device. This restriction has raised many concerns in discussion in 802.11, so it has led to new channel access rules for NSTR devices. So the motivation of this work is to study these rules closely and find how they would work in a typical Wi-Fi network with legacy devices. The goal of this study is to analyze the performance of NSTR MLDs together with the legacy devices, applying the rules defined in the latest 11BE draft 1.3. So let us start with the basics. I will assume that you are familiar with EDCA used in modern Wi-Fi networks. If not, I will refer you to the source displayed down here on the slide as an example. And for NSTR MLD channel access, 11BE defines the following. Each station of the MLD runs its own EDCA function. That is, the back-off counters are decremented depending only on the channel state of a corresponding link, independently from the other links. And once the back-off counter on one of the links, for example, link 1 as shown here, reaches 0, the corresponding station has two options. The first option is to start a transmission as shown here. Since there is a degree of freedom for MLDs which link to choose first, they will perform better unlike legacy devices, with the only restriction that once the transmission on one link has started, all other links shall freeze their back-off counters. In the second case, shown on the right, the station postpones its transmission and waits for another link. During that, it keeps the back-off value on link 2 at 0, as shown here. And when link 2 finishes its back-off, NSTR MLD performs a synchronous transmission that should boost the performance of the MLD. We call those options no waiting and waiting options, respectively. We will describe one more approach that is motivated by the following observation. When legacy devices are present in the network, both links are idle at the same time very rarely. So MLDs would have little chance to perform synchronous transmissions. And a way one could tackle this problem is to align the ends of the transmissions in two links. In our study, it works as follows. An MLD senses the channel and detects a Wi-Fi frame sent by some other device on link 1. The preamble of Wi-Fi frame signals its duration, so if MLD knows that duration and gains channel access on link 2, it could transmit a frame or a sequence of frames so that the end of the data frame finishes at the same time as that on link 1, within some margin. After that, both links become free at the same time. Intuitively, this approach, which we call alignment, should enable more frequent synchronous transmissions by NSTR MLDs and boost their performance. So we choose to compare three channel access approaches: no waiting, waiting, and waiting with alignment. To compare the approaches, we use the following scenario. In a heterogeneous network, there is one multilink AP that supports STR, and the client devices, some of which are legacy, while others are NSTR MLDs. The client devices transmit data with AMPDUs, which contain MPDUs uniformly distributed from 50 to 64. All other parameters are listed in this table. We consider two scenarios. In the symmetric scenario, the number of legacy devices is equal on each link, whereas in the asymmetric scenario, there are no legacy devices on link 1. All client devices have saturated traffic and there is no downlink traffic from the AP. Let us start with the symmetric scenario. In the figure, you can see that per device throughput for MLDs on the left and for legacy devices on the right. The numbers at the bottom are the notation representing the number of legacy devices on link 1, link 2, and MLDs respectively. The first observation is that both waiting and no waiting options provide almost the same results. It happens because the MLDs rarely transmit synchronously, even when there is only one legacy device in each link. And the chances of two links being idle simultaneously are very low. The next observation is that in the symmetric scenario, the per device throughput of the MLDs is 55 to 65% of that from legacy devices. So multilink does provide some gain, but it is far from 100%. The reason is when an MLD performs a single link transmission, it suspends its back of counter on the other link, while the legacy devices can continue contending in that link. Next, we see that waiting plus alignment option does not provide the desirable throughput gain for MLDs, but actually does the opposite. It happens mainly because MLDs shorten their AMPDUs to perform the alignments, so less payload is transmitted per channel access. Although the number of joint transmissions for MLD increases, the total throughput decreases. Moreover, our results show that the probability of winning the channel access contention is low after restarting back off if at least one legacy device is present on the link. In this case, a legacy device needs only one back off counter to expire, while MLD needs both of its back off counters to expire to perform synchronous transmission. This explains the throughput spike for legacy devices in the case 116. The less legacy devices there are in the network, the less contention is there between them and the more throughput they get. Finally, let us see the results for a symmetric scenario. Here we can see a similar picture. No waiting and waiting options show no difference, even though the legacy stations occupy only one channel on the second link. MLDs in this scenario have a much higher gain compared to legacy devices, and this is due to their independent operation on link 1, where there are no other devices other than MLDs. So in this case, it boils down to a situation where MLDs perform similar to legacy devices, just in a separate and independent channel. And similar to the symmetric scenario, MLDs do not profit from alignment, but legacy devices do, especially when there are few of them. So let me summarize. We have studied the multilink operation, one of the key innovations of the upcoming 802.11be standard amendment. Specifically, we have analyzed the performance of NSTR MLDs in a heterogeneous network with high load, where legacy devices are present. We have found that multilink allows to get some gain compared to legacy devices, but it is noticeably less than 100%. The synchronous transmissions, which should lead to higher gain for NSTR MLDs, are hardly possible in such scenario because of low chances of two links being idle at the same time. And an intuitive approach to increase such chances to align transmissions in two links does not provide the benefit for MLDs which we would expect. From these results, we conclude that there is a strong need for an alternative channel access scheme for NSTR MLDs that would provide higher gain. And this is actually our future work, and we expect to get some interesting results soon. Okay, this concludes my presentation. If you have any questions, you are welcome, and you can also email me using the address shown on the slide. Thank you very much.